Please welcome Joe Reagan, President of the St. Louis Regional Chamber. Public Safety in Sykeston and the third Vice President of the Missouri Police Chiefs Association. Mr. Brian Coffey, CEO of the San Jose Hospital in Osceola. Jim Shortle from the Board of Directors for the National Alliance on Mental Illness. Heidi Miller from the Family Healthcare Center in St. Louis. Dr. Cheryl Dalton, a family nurse practitioner and health home director of Access Family Care in Neosho. The Reverend Doyle Sager, pastor of the First Baptist Church here in Jefferson City. And our very special guest, Governor Jay Nixon and First Lady Georgia been in the ministry for more than 25 years. His preaching and his teaching focuses on empowerment and hope. Please welcome Pastor Ronnie Webb to lead in today's invocation.
God bless you. Shall we pray at this time? Shall we bow our heads? Our God, our Father, we honor you today and we honor your presence that's in this place. Lord God, you called us through the prophets to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly before you. In doing so, we seek your guidance today for this issue that's at hand. We call upon you in the name of the Lord to bless our governor and to all of our leaders. And we also call upon our legislators to do the righteous thing, and that's to vote for Medicaid expansion. We are challenged today through the prophets and through Jesus to care for the least ones. So today we become a voice to the vulnerable. And God, I pray that you'll grant us favor for the facing of this hour. And we know that when we pray, God, you hear us when we pray. And right now we give you the glory, we give you the honor, and we give you the praise. And Lord, by faith, we count this done. We thank you for a miracle that's taking place in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Webb. And good afternoon, Missouri. The expansion and reform of Medicaid is incredibly important to the future health of the state, the people of Missouri, and to our economy. It's also important to Bothell Regional Health Center, our 9-member board of trustees, the more than 850 employees that we have, the more than 100 physicians that practice in our region, the more than 180 volunteers who give of their time, and especially to the 70,000 people we serve. Bothell, like all hospitals in our great state, provides millions of dollars in uncompensated care. Nearly 1 in 5 of the patients we see in our emergency department have no health insurance. Expanding Medicaid would extend coverage to about 4,200 people in our area, and in many cases, these are the working poor who are cobbling together multiple part-time jobs without benefits to help make ends meet. Without Medicaid expansion, Bothell and many other rural hospitals must consider cuts in services. That's something that none of us want to see because the communities we serve deserve the very best access and care close to their homes. Today, you're going to be hearing from folks from the front lines on this issue, folks from law enforcement, business groups, and healthcare leaders. These are folks who know how important it is to bring our tax dollars back to Missouri from Washington, D.C. to strengthen Medicaid right here in Missouri. Folks who know that healthy families make a healthy economy and a safer community. First up is Joe Regan, CEO of the St. Louis Regional Chamber. Joe has more than 20 years of executive experience in the private sector, focusing on community and economic development. As CEO of the St. Louis Chamber, Joe is committed to making sure that businesses in his region have the workforce they need and the health care they deserve. Please welcome CEO of the St. Louis Regional Chamber, Joe Regan.
Good afternoon. It's an honor to be standing here today along with colleagues from business organizations across our great state to be here with Governor Nixon at this important time on a most important issue. I represent the St. Louis Regional Chamber of Commerce. We're a broad community of leaders united for economic prosperity across the entire bi-state region of St. Louis. And as we look at that issue of economic prosperity, we are here today out of principles. Our principle is to support full, affordable, and comprehensive access to health insurance and a robust healthcare system that protects the interests of employers while addressing the needs of patients, providers, and payers. We likewise support timely and adequate funding of state programs, including Medicaid, as well as funding mechanisms that enhance the use of federal funds. And further, we oppose the shifting of costs of the uninsured to entrepreneurs and employers, and we impose health insurance mandates that undermine the provision of high-quality insurance at a reasonable cost. So, in consideration of all of these positions, and being mindful of our strongly held beliefs about government fiscal responsibility, we stand here today as a regional chamber in the conclusion that expansion of Medicaid in Missouri under the Federal Affordable Care Act is certainly the most prudent course of action for our state. We are not alone in this business position. We are joined by 60 other business organizations from across our state, some of who are here today, who share and share this endorsement. We believe that this will help reduce the uninsured population, prevent further cost shifting, create jobs, and improve the health of our workforce. And most important, for the St. Louis region, one of our great opportunities for the future is growing our health economy. It's one of our true regional strengths in our global competition for jobs. And our health employers have told us they're not going to be able to grow if they have to deal with this $2 billion hole in our health economy in the state. And we want to grow and we want to create jobs. And so for all those reasons, it's our honor to stand here today. It's our honor to show up. We showed up today because it's our time. It's our time as the Show Me State to show up. It's our time for our state to be a place where people show up to work, healthy people show up to work ready to contribute, where healthy kids show up to class ready to learn. And where we all show up together to solve our toughest problems facing the state. And that's what we believe is what we're doing today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joe. Up next is Police Chief Drew June, who also serves as the Director of Public Safety in Sykeston. Chief Jin has been with the Sykeston Department of Public Safety since 1978 and is currently sits on the Board of Directors for the Southeast Missouri Major Case Squad, the Southeast Missouri Drug Task Force, and is a founding member of the Southeast Missouri Bomb Team. He also sits on the Homeland Security Advisory Council for the state and was recently elected as the third Vice President of the Missouri Police Chiefs Association. Please welcome Sykeston Public Safety Director Chief Drew June.
It's a pleasure to be here this afternoon and speak on behalf of all law enforcement across the state. For all law enforcement leaders, our most important mission is the protection of our civilian population. It is our highest priority. But police officers cannot solve every public safety problem. The vast majority of people with mental health illnesses are not violent. However, in law enforcement, we often encounter those individuals who are violent. And this is a small portion, a very small portion of the mental health community. These individuals become threats not only to themselves sometimes, but to the community. And it's important as law enforcement that we expend our sacred resources protecting the citizens of our community. Family members, neighbors, and workers, all members of our communities. Let me give you an example of an experience we had earlier this month. We had an individual that was committed by court order to a mental health facility. Two of my officers transported this individual 3.5 hours across the state. We've dealt with this individual many times, and this is one of the individuals who's in that small minority who becomes very, very violent at times. The two officers transported him to the facility, left him there to care of the facility, and came back to Sykeston. The next day, without notifying us, this facility put this gentleman on a bus and sent him back to Sykeston because he was too violent for the facility to handle. The day after that, this individual's caretaker again acquired a court order for him. Again, we transported this individual 3.5 hours to a different part of the state. My officers arrived there and they were told there was no beds available. They sat for 2.5 hours in the emergency department, finally contacting one of my command staff members, who contacted the nurse on duty, the supervising nurse on duty, and they found a bed for this individual. These officers had worked an 8-hour patrol shift and transported this individual 3.5 hours, and as you can imagine, were very tired. So therefore, we had to provide a motel for them that evening before they could return home the next day, another 3.5 hour journey. This mentally ill individual, as I said earlier, becomes violent. It is not fair to him to transport him all across this state to different facilities. He needs to get the care that he needs, and we need to try to have that care locally. It makes no sense to have our police officers hip-hopping across the state when they need to be at home or in our county protecting the citizens that they're paid to protect. Fortunately, there's a clear answer here, and the answer is the strength of Medicaid. Medicaid will help give these people the treatment that they need. It will ease the burden on local law enforcement. It will keep our police officers and sheriff's deputies where they belong. That's why I'm proud to join with all the other law enforcement officers that are here to support this common sense approach that it will take to strengthen Medicaid, enhance our public safety, and strengthen local law enforcement. Thank you.
CEO of the Sacramento Sage Hospital in Osceola. Brian and his wife have a passion for rural living and rural health care, serving a variety of health care leadership roles for nearly a decade. Brian recently led the team at Sacramento Sage to increase access to care and to improve the quality of care for their patients. Please welcome CEO of Sacramento Sage Hospital, Osceola, Dr. Brian Coffey.
Thank you. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here to be able to talk about rural health care. It is my passion. Governor Nixon has a great proposal to expand Medicaid. We can talk about the numbers, but really what it means in rural Missouri, it's about your friends and your neighbors. There are 37% of Missourians live in rural areas. That's 2.2 million people that are impacted by rural health care. What does life mean without Medicaid expansion, as Governor Nixon has proposed it? It means tough times for hospitals in small towns. They may not make it. What does it mean if they don't make it in rural Missouri? Well, I want you to look to your left and look to your right, because 1 in 4 people who have a heart attack present at a rural hospital first before their life flighted out or treated locally. 1 in 4. What does that mean if rural hospitals are not able to provide services? Do you want to take the chance that you're that 1 in 4 that has to wait hours while undergoing a heart attack, or worse yet, a stroke? But we can't afford that risk. So when we talk about numbers like 133% of the federal poverty level versus 100%, these aren't just numbers, these are people making a living. What does 133% of the federal poverty level mean? Brothers and sisters, that is minimum wage. So if you're not making minimum wage, you're not able to qualify under any of the programming Governor Nixon's. So are we talking about a free handout for takers in rural America? That's not what rural Missourians are. Rural Missourians are hard workers. They're working in the feed mill, working at the local grocery store, they're working at the gas station. So as you go home from here and you have to stop for gas, think about this. That person working at that clerk desk at the gas station, can they afford insurance on their minimum wage job currently? No. No, they can't. What will it mean in rural America? It means that we'll be taking care of those hardworking Americans who are paying tax dollars. Those Missouri tax dollars will help Missourians and not people in Massachusetts and California and Texas. Rest assured that if we do nothing, those Missouri tax dollars from all those hardworking rural Missourians, they're going to help other people in other states. Let's look to show Missourians that we care and expand Medicaid under Governor Nixon's proposal.
Jim Shortle, a mental health services advocate and consumer. As a member of the board of directors of the National Alliance on Mental Illness, Jim is a statewide consumer advocate, opening opportunities and breaking down stigmas for this community. Please welcome Jim Shortle.
Wow. What a turnout from all over the state. Give yourselves a hand. Thank you, and especially thank you, Governor Nixon, for your unqualified support of Medicaid expansion. Medicaid expansion will benefit not only our businesses and our workers. Medicaid expansion will also benefit many of our sickest, our poorest, our weakest, and our disenfranchised. Therefore, I respectfully request that both of our parties, Republicans and Democrats alike, put aside the partisan politics of healthcare, and instead, base your vote on the moral and economic benefits of Medicaid expansion. It's not only the right thing to do, it makes good business sense. I'm here on behalf of the one of 17 persons who suffers from a severe mental illness, according to a 2009 report of the U.S. Surgeon General. Mental illness does not discriminate. It touches all of us, rich and poor, even Republicans and Democrats. We know that mental illness exists in every state, every city and town, in every neighborhood. What many of us don't know is that mental health disorders are more common than cancer, diabetes, or heart disease. Accordingly, next page. I am also here because I'm one of those 17 Missourians who live with a severe mental illness. For many years, I was a successful entrepreneur and small business owner. 5 years ago, my world fell apart due to my disease, bipolar 2 disorder. I lost everything, my company, my home, and my family. Today, thanks to Medicaid, I'm in recovery and a grateful example of mental wellness. People like me can and do recover when they are able to access and pay for appropriate treatment and support services. In other words, treatment works if you can get it. I was one of the lucky ones. I was able to access mental health care services because I qualified for Medicaid insurance, which helped me pay for my psychiatrist and my medication. Some people maintain that our current Medicaid system is broken, but it worked for me when I needed it. Medicaid literally helped save my life. In fiscal year 2010, only one of five Missourians with mental health needs received care. What happens to those who can't afford to access care? Where do they go? Those unable to obtain services have no alternative but to utilize other substantially more costly public services such as emergency rooms, hospitals, homeless shelters, jails, and prisons. It's morally reprehensible and financially unacceptable that the single largest population of persons with mental illness is housed in the Cook County, Chicago County Jail, followed by the Los Angeles County Jail. Not only is this sad fact a moral outrage, it is extremely cost ineffective for the states of Illinois and California. Even sadder is the fact that other states, including Missouri, are moving in that direction. It's true, our jails and prisons are de facto our country's modern-day asylums. In closing, I agree that our system is in need of transformation and reform. Federal expansion dollars will provide the seed capital to implement those reforms. Medicaid expansion will greatly change Missouri's mental health care system for the better by moving it toward earlier intervention for people developing mental illness and substance use disorders. Not extending Medicaid eligibility will not allow our state to improve its community outpatient services and runs the high risk of severely damaging its psychiatric inpatient services. It's important to realize that people with mental health disabilities can and do recover and become like being employed, self-insured, and a tax-paying citizen. Medicaid expansion will give many others the opportunity to do so, will allow many Missourians to move forward on their road to recovery while ultimately saving the state considerable public costs related to mental illness. It is not only the right thing to do, it makes good business sense. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Up next is Dr. Heidi Miller of the Family Care Center, Health Center in St. Louis. Dr. Miller is a Harvard-trained physician and passionate advocate for the Federally Qualified Health Centers program. Dr. Miller is no stranger to advocating for better health care for all Missourians, and she's traveled to Jefferson City numerous times to meet with legislators about the critical role that federally qualified health centers play in the safety net of our system. Please welcome Dr. Heidi Miller.
This driver, they are all my patients. They are our neighbors. They are Missouri residents. They pay their taxes, and their federal tax payments will be used to fund the Medicaid expansion for other people in other states unless enough of our legislators hear us today. So much. I humbly ask our representatives to witness and understand the uninsured before they judge, to acknowledge the unnecessary suffering that sometimes even resembles third world medicine in our state borders. I ask our representatives to realize that even if a patient comes to me as a primary care doctor, that my hands are tied if they have an inflamed gallbladder that needs to be removed. And I ask them to calculate the human cost and the glaringly inefficient use of expensive medical resources if we wait for that gallbladder to explode and burst its toxic contents in their inner abdomen. I ask our legislators to realize the endangered species status of our workforce. There are currently too few of us to take care of our Missourians. If we delay, even 1 year, if we delay, our nurses and doctors will leave. They are being aggressively recruited to other states that also have workforce shortages and realize that they need to fill their ranks to meet their new demands for their Medicaid expansion, and I cringe to witness this.
That occur with this chronic illness. Well, this man uncontrolled and he had to go on numerous medications that he could not afford. He was not able to continue. In fact, people would label him as non-compliant. But the working poor cannot afford their health care and sometimes have to make decisions to pay the rent or to buy their medicines. So he is not non-compliant. He is not able to take care of his health care needs. And this gentleman ended up with a very bad foot infection and ended up in the hospital, nearly losing his foot. His disease progressed. That was his first hospitalization. Still unable to get health insurance, he went back to work trying to take care of his family. His second hospitalization was when he, as the doctor said, had crushing chest pain and had his first heart attack. The heart attack weakened his heart, and now he has diabetes, coronary artery disease, hypertension, and heart failure. His third hospitalization, still unable to get any kind of health insurance, was because of the heart failure, his kidneys began to fail. And oh, by the way, there's also a condition called retinopathy that he developed, and he's now nearly blind. So now we have a 45-year-old patient who has diabetes, who's almost blind, he's on kidney dialysis, and he has heart failure. But now he's on complete disability and can get health insurance. And this is the tragedy that we face every day. 3 months ago, we had a 14-year-old child who came to see us who also cannot get health insurance. She also has uncontrolled diabetes. She can't afford to see the specialist that she so dearly needs to see. She's on insulin and her family can't afford her medication. She too is walking the path that this 45-year-old man had to walk, where she can't afford her health care. She's 14 years old, looking down at the path of blindness, kidney failure, heart failure, before she's even in her 30s. This is a tragedy that our working poor have to face every single day. So I implore you to consider to put names and faces to these numbers that you hear when you're making these decisions for expanding Medicaid. It is the right thing to do. And as the pastor said, that we are implored by God for justice and mercy. And this is justice and mercy to expand Medicaid. Thank you.
Albany, Missouri, and has served as the senior pastor of First Baptist Church here since 1997. Pastor Sager currently serves as the president of the Baptist General Convention of Missouri and on the Board of Trustees of William Jewell College in Liberty. Please welcome Pastor Doyle Sager.
Good afternoon, Governor, Mrs. Nixon. I'm here not only as a local pastor, but to represent Missouri Faith Voices, a network of over 200 congregations and faith communities throughout our great state of Missouri. I stand before you this afternoon to speak on behalf of the 300,000 hardworking Missourians who could be included in Missouri's health care if we have the political and moral will to bring it about. In the halls of this Capitol, all session long, there are teeming groups of individuals advocating for their particular special interests. Hundreds of thousands of dollars are spent for these lobbyists to protect the rights and privileges of those who already have affordable health care, including our legislators. For the thousands upon thousands of Missourians who are left out and left behind. Who lobbies for them? We do. We're here today to lobby for them. But be clear about something else. We're not the only lobbyists for these left out and left behind. The ancient Hebrew prophets bear testimony as lobbyists for these who are hurting and marginalized. They cry out, "Let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream." And Jesus of Nazareth calls us to care for the least and the struggling and the forgotten among us, because we all bear God's image and because we are all deserving of the dignity bestowed on us by our Creator. I believe with all my heart that history and God Almighty will judge us for what we do with this opportunity for expanded health care. I refuse to accept as the norm 800,000 uninsured Missourians when we have it in our power to help them help themselves. State that is so rich in natural resources could be so depleted when it comes to justice. And I refuse to believe that Missouri's supply of compassion is below the poverty level. Our state motto reads, "The welfare of the people shall be the supreme law." There is no higher law than the welfare of all Missourians. We implore our elected officials to do the right thing and make this happen.
Has been a person deeply committed to making sure that in every corner of Missouri there are jobs, opportunities, and access to health care. It's my privilege to call up Governor Jay Nixon.
100,000 Missourians, including 50,000 who need mental health treatment. $5.7 billion coming back to Missouri over 3 years. 100% of the costs covered by federal funds. 24,000 jobs created in the first year alone. That is why executives and educators, cops and clinicians, doctors and dentists in every corner of our state have come out in support of this common sense plan. Unquestionably the smart thing to do. But set aside all the jargon, all the data, all the stuff about cost shifting and uncompensated care, all the economic impact statements and budget projections. And you just can't ignore it. That strengthening Medicaid is also the right thing to do. Your senators and your representatives, with health care paid for by you, if tomorrow they came down with the flu, broke an ankle, or noticed a lump where there shouldn't be one, they could walk into a doctor's office or a clinic and take a card out of their wallet or their pocket. They'd slide that card across the front desk, the clerk would smile and write down the numbers, and they would get the care they needed. But hundreds of thousands of working Missourians don't have one of those cards. They wait tables and clean office buildings. They work the night shift at factories and repair cars and trucks. They watch our children and take care of our grandmothers and grandfathers on the night shift. They work tough, low-paying jobs that don't offer health benefits, and they can't afford to buy the coverage on their own. But because of their income, they can't qualify for Medicaid. So they live in a world much different than most of us. A world where it's easier for a worker to get health care by quitting a job than by taking one. Folks, that is flat wrong. A world where a single mother with a serious illness doesn't get the treatment that can save her life. A world where a father can work hard all day and night and still just be one injury away from medical bankruptcy. That's not right. And we can, and we must fix it. Strengthening Medicaid will allow these hardworking Missourians to keep a job and their health coverage. You know it. I know it. Deep down, everybody here in the state capitol knows it. Making it easier for hundreds of thousands of working Missourians to get basic health care is the right thing to do. Never before. My 26 years of public service, and probably never again in the lifetimes of anybody here, will we have such a clear opportunity to do this much good for this many people. And that is exactly why our chorus of voices must be heard today. Said here are turned into action up there. Our time is short. Our message is clear, and no one else can make the case for you. Only your voices can give them the courage to take this important step. Only your voices can help them understand the need. Only your voices can help them look inside their hearts to do what they know is right. our moment. With your help, we will look back on this day as the beginning of a brighter, healthier future for our state, not an opportunity that passed us by. So as I told folks all across the state, as I traveled the state and talked about this issue, the only problem that I've had is that every room that we booked for these meetings all across the state have not been big enough. Everywhere I've looked have been people. People interested, knowledgeable. Okay? So it is incredibly vital that each and every one of you not pass to your fellow citizen the responsibility to communicate with your elected representatives. Do that yourself. Each and every person here. When 2,000 people knock on those doors up there, makes the smart choice, the right choice, and brings the dollars we send to Washington right back to make a difference here in Missouri. Thank you, and God bless.
Access to health care for working Missourians. Thank you.